Hi everyone, this is John Oltsik, analyst in residence at theCUBE, and I'm here with my colleague Jackie McGuire, live at RSA 2025 with theCUBE. And we're joined by Markus Ludwig, who is the CEO and co-founder of Ticura. Welcome Markus, welcome Jackie.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks for having me, it's a pleasure.
So Markus, let's start. I mean, so tell us what Ticura is and what it does.
Oh, yeah. So Ticura stands actually for Threat Intelligence Curation. This is where the name came from. And we founded Ticura around 4 years, nearly 4 years ago. Actually, our release date was last year around San Francisco. So it's a GA birthday, so you can say, right? Yeah. What we do is threat intelligence curation. It's actually using analytics and automation to optimize a threat intelligence program, optimize a portfolio of any use case, no matter which market, which size of a company, no matter if it's an MSSP, large enterprises, or even smaller, medium business companies.
Okay, and who are your primary customers now?
Now it's mainly security service providers. Okay. That is our sweet spot customer. And also security solution vendors.
Yeah. Seems like we've almost gone from not enough threat intelligence information to now there's so much that without some way to curate and sort through it and prioritize it, it can kind of be overwhelming. It's almost like alert fatigue, but intelligence fatigue, right?
Yeah, exactly, spot on. That's exactly the story. If you look at how much threat intelligence exists today, and it is the fuel of cybersecurity. No matter what you do in cyber, you have to look at the intelligence behind that. And there is so much, it's so fragmented, so crowded, that space. Open source, free sources, structured, unstructured information, strategic information, operational information. So the power you have to invest to actually understand what exists and how to consume it and what is right for me or my use case or for my customers, that is super expensive for a company and not to handle actually without analytics and automation.
And it's an area where there's an acute skills shortage. So we talk about the security skills shortage at large, but if you look at specific areas, that's one where you've got threat analysts who worked in government or intelligence agencies, or they work at big companies, big tech companies, or you have almost nothing.
Yeah, absolutely. Shortage of skills is a real threat, right? And this is where AI may come into play or is coming into play. It helps to scale that part, right? Without scaling with real people, because you're not able to scale with real people.
Yeah, and I think, you know, when you mentioned how many different sources there are of threat intelligence, I think what was surprising to me, I worked at a data pipeline company, and you oftentimes need an entire person just to handle bringing that data together, because you have open source, you have subscription services, you have the stuff that's built into your SIM. So I imagine that having some way to get all of that in one place and prioritize probably saves at least some headcount. Because it's a full-time job, and I don't know that a lot of security teams have someone full-time dedicated just to getting all of the data in.
Yeah, in larger companies, larger MSSPs, it wouldn't be sufficient to have one person. Yeah. You have threat hunters who are doing nothing else than just looking out for what is currently going on, right? What is relevant for me now? And again, that doesn't scale, right? More threats, if you think about using or utilizing AI to speed up new threats that are coming up from the bad guys, yeah. You need to do something, you can't do it manually, right?
And tell me how you're not a threat intelligence platform or a tip, because the way you describe it, someone could easily come away from this interview and say, oh, it's just another threat intelligence platform. They've been around for years, how are you different?
Yeah, a threat intelligence platform is actually the target product, would be one of the target products of our outcome. A tip typically is the interface to threat intelligence information for analysts, for people, for threat hunters. what we are is the step before. We make threat intelligence measurable and comparable, then look what is relevant for a use case, for a team, for a company, and then give it to you in a consumable way with a few clicks. It just takes a few minutes. Now, we don't want to be another threat intelligence vendor. We don't want to be another threat intelligence platform. We want to be the part that relieves the teams from doing the manual work of understanding what is relevant for me.
And with a security services provider, I imagine the curation is different from one customer to the next of them, right? So the curation that they need for the tip for one customer is not going to be what they need for a tip for a different customer. So I imagine their needs are kind of exponential compared to an individual customer. So that's, I can see why you've had success there and that they would need to create custom feeds per the stacks that they're managing, right?
Yeah, and that isn't possible as of today. So MSSPs can't do that. Even if most of them or some of them are claiming to do so, it's hard for them to really, even if you do it once, it's no longer valid tomorrow because new threats come up, new sources come up, threat intelligence sources get outdated, right? How do you keep track with that? How do you keep that up to date without automation? And that is the analytics. We are currently analyzing more than 1,000 threat intelligence sources continuously in real time. Mm-hmm. And we measure them. How fast are they? What do they cover? How relevant are they for which industry? For which type of threats, right? And then with a few clicks, you can actually incorporate that intelligence like fuel into your security operations.
Yeah. And so, how do you work with the ISACs?
Oh, that's a good one, yeah. We are a member FSISAC Expert Resource Pool, are working closely with them, and also from the ITISAC, for example. What we do is we incorporate their intelligence and we deliver that to their own customers or members. That means we now identify what is relevant for the customer, a bank in the US, for example, or a European bank, right? And then we manage the data so it fits and is converged and contextualized to the needs of the customer. So we converge also FSISAC information with open source or commercial vendors, and then bring one picture to the customer. They don't need to converge the data locally, yeah.
Yeah, then Jackie's point to start was spot on, because in my experience, there's this more is better kind of mindset, and more isn't better. If I'm a healthcare organization in the United States, I need threat intelligence that's relevant to me. So how do you make that, I don't know, how do you do that and how do you make it affordable? Because if I'm a regional hospital, obviously I can't afford all of the commercial threat feeds that might be available.
Yeah, there are two aspects to look at when talking about that. Number one is the more the better, the more noise the better it is? No, for sure not, right? But the more sources you get, the more noise you will get. Mm-hmm. Cutting through the noise, and I know that we have a term here that says extracting the signal from the noise.
Yeah.
Our saying is more signal, less noise, right?
Pretty close.
Yeah.
Pretty close, so it's a perfect fit here. What we do is we categorize the noise continuously by converging the information from more than 200 informational sources continuously, and then label categories where companies actually can decide what is noise, what is not noise. Do I need that? Should that be filtered? Do I need that information? So it's super easy. It's really selecting little checkboxes and you are done with noise categorization and filtering. Second story, coming to the budget. You're totally right. When talking about the budgets, if I give you a recommendation that contains the 15 most expensive threat intelligence feeds, how good is that recommendation if your budget is $150,000 per year, right? It's not optimal at all. So we also optimize to the budget. You can specify what is your budget, and you can select even no commercial vendors, just
Just open source.
Okay. Just open source. And you get the best out of open source with applied false positive prevention.
It's one of the reasons that one of my kind of theories, and I guess I can't really take credit for this because it's already happening, is that...
Oh, take credit.
Well, you know, I've been writing for a couple years that managed services and managed security services are going to explode because most small and mid-sized businesses have kind of done okay up until now, but the exponential nature with which the attack surface is growing and threats are multiplying, and then you add this kind of AI automated nature to the threats, and I just think by the 2030, I find it hard to believe that most, you know, sub 5,000 employee businesses will be able to manage their own security. I think from a cyber risk insurance perspective, that's going to get more expensive. Just threat intelligence too. Like, if you can't afford a six-figure threat intelligence feed, then you probably need to be using a service provider because you probably can't afford the people to go through that feed either.
True. Yeah. Yeah, if you think about that, let's go away from the larger companies. Let's look at the small companies. Mm-hmm. They are more and more a spot, a target of actors, right? There is also money there, mm-hmm. and they can't afford any of that. They need a security service provider. That is a very, very much growing market, serving the SMB market. Yep. As a security service provider. How do you scale there, if not with automation and AI, right? Yes. No chance at all.
And we all have a shared fate. So, you know, I've seen some of the largest Fortune 50s go down because their 10-person vendor got ransomware and their sensitive corporate data was sitting at that 10-person ransomware company. So I almost think we sometimes use size as an excuse for bad security posture, but the reality is that a lot of big, big tech companies are taken down by their very small vendors, so it's probably worth paying extra attention to SMBs, especially the ones in the B2B business, because, yeah, and I have seen ransomware attackers moving further down the chain as large companies stopped paying. Their cyber risk policies don't pay and they won't pay the ransom anymore, so they're like, smaller companies have less ability to negotiate and it's in their best interest to pay and move on, so I anticipate that'll probably continue just from an economics perspective.
Yeah, the weakest part in the chain, right?
Yeah. Yep. Yeah.
There's always one.
Yeah.
So another question that I think of is, I'm a big fan of the threat-informed defense, which is a MITRE model. Mm. So how do you align with the MITRE attack framework?
Yeah, it's actually a part of the contextualization, right? Everything that goes in needs to have the MITRE attack information, the techniques, the tactics assigned to it. Mm-hmm. It's essential for any security operations. It's attached to any information.
Attached to everything. Yeah. And what about downstream? So, and Jackie mentioned this, is like, I want to take that threat intelligence and I want to feed it into reports. I want to feed it into my SIM. I might want to feed it into my XDR. I might have spent like cloud security people. So how does that work?
Yeah, that's a good one. The best threat intelligence doesn't help you if you are not able to consume it easily. Right?
Operationalize, yes.
Yes. So one part is that we support as many products, formats, data schemas as possible. That means if a customer steps up and says, I am using the following tip, or I'm using this theme like an MS Sentinel versus a Curator,
Maybe not Curator.
bad example. But let's talk about OpenCTI versus MISP, right? Maybe I need Stix Taxi in version 2.1, or I need just a JSON lines format. Mm-hmm. We are taking care that it always is also optimized to the target consuming product mm-hmm. and to your needs. That's important.
Yeah. Your data scientists appreciate that because being someone who used to write detections for a SIM and having to get those things into a JSON dictionary to do something with them with pandas, I really appreciate getting it in JSON right away because we didn't have LLMs to do that for us back in my day.
Yeah, and otherwise, talk about the work that's involved.
Literally, the first 3 weeks I was a data scientist at a SIM, I was just beating my face with regex against syslog trying to get it into a JSON. JSON dictionary so I could do something with it. And it's, yeah, if you think about what I was making an hour, which wasn't a lot, I was an entry-level data scientist, but multiply that by 3 weeks worth of my time. And that a tool that could have done that in one click would have definitely, I would have spent a lot more time writing detections and a lot less time just trying to wrangle data. So we should probably ask an RSA question since we're at RSA. So
please do.
What is the number one thing you're looking forward to learning more about at RSA this year? I know we're all coming in the midst of a massive hype cycle. So, but what are you looking forward to?
First and foremost, most of the conversations I have are typically outside of the conference centers.
Yeah.
Hopping from one meeting room
not
to the other.
One. Yeah. You're right.
Not this one. The good
it's
stuff
the
happens
most
here.
Important one, right?
Yeah.
And the first one I had.
Yeah.
But talking with those people gives us a much better impression. What are the needs? What are companies looking for? What are solution vendors looking for heading towards, right? And we do have all types of conversations with customers we already have, with partners we already have, potential new partners, potential vendor partnerships, alliances, and you get a very good picture. There is no other place, in my opinion, where you can meet so many people in reality, because there is still a difference if you are sitting in front of someone or if you are looking at a screen, right? Yeah.
Note to everybody, get out from the conferences and go actually talk to people at happy hours, because
that's where the real buzz is. I said that to John Furrier before.
Yeah.
It's in the hallways, it's in the dinner meetings that you really understand, and it's talking to practitioners.
Yeah.
But Markus, thank you for stopping by. We appreciate the time. And stay tuned for more from theCUBE live at RSA 2025. Moving forward, thanks a lot.
Thank you.